point 3 nautical miles, downrange distance 3 nautical miles. Engines throttling up 3.
On January 28, 1986, 73 seconds after it launched, the Space Shuttle Challenger suffered a catastrophic failure and exploded, killing all 7 crew members aboard. This was one of the worst events to befall the space program, and the loss of life was absolutely tragic. Unsurprisingly, a massive investigation was undertaken to understand what went wrong. This Rogers Commission concluded that the disaster was a result of unusually cold weather on the day of the launch that resulted in a set of O-rings failing to seal the solid rocket boosters, which resulted in significant aerodynamic destabilization and ultimate explosion. But the report went on further to conclude that one of the most telling failures wasn't one of engineering, but rather the poor use and understanding of statistics. Welcome to Data Demystified. I'm Jeff Gallick, and in this episode, I'm going to show you how a failure in statistical reasoning by some of the smartest scientists and engineers in the world led to the tragic Challenger disaster. In particular, we're going to focus on how selective use of data can dramatically influence the conclusions we might draw. So let's jump in and see what went so tragically wrong. The night before the launch, the engineers at Thiokol, the company that made the solid rocket boosters that ultimately failed, and the engineers and scientists at NASA, had a prolonged meeting where they discussed the risk that the O-rings have of failing at low temperatures, since the upcoming launch day was going to be around 39 degrees Fahrenheit, the coldest temperature for a launch to that date. In that meeting, this chart was used to make the claim that the temperature really has no effect on how likely O-rings are to fail. I'm going to recreate this chart and make it a bit nicer to look at so that we can see how that conclusion was formed. Each of those dots represents previous launches where an O-ring had failed in some capacity. Not enough to destroy the space shuttle, but enough to take note. On the horizontal axis is the temperature the day the launch took place, and on the vertical axis is the count of the number of failure incidents for that particular launch. What the engineers did was try and compare the temperature on previous launch days to the likelihood of O-ring failures. And what they did was say something like, look, sometimes it's hot and sometimes it's cold. O-rings fail roughly equally at all temperatures. In other words, just because the Challenger will launch on a cold day doesn't increase the risk of O-ring failure any more than if it launched on a warm day. But can you spot the problem? Can you see what the engineers did so tragically wrong? Well, there are actually two things. First, note that the coldest day that they have data for was January 1st, 1985, when it was 53 degrees Fahrenheit. The upcoming launch was going to be 14 degrees colder, well outside the range for which there was safety data. The first problem is that when building a statistical model, which this is a very simple example of, that model is only as good as the data you put into it. If the model is calibrated on data that only include a small range of possible inputs, a limited range of temperatures in this example, that model is virtually useless in making predictions for anything outside of that range. As a quick and perhaps overly obvious example of this, if I plot the relationship between age and median height for men between ages 20 and 50, I get something like this. If we saw this, we'd conclude that age has nothing to do with how tall someone is. But of course, we all realize that age is a very strong predictor of height, just not in this range of ages. If I instead expand this to be the age from birth to 50 years, we see that age is a phenomenal predictor of height, but only until about age 20. The point is that if we try and draw conclusions from a limited range of data, and then apply those conclusions to a different range of data, we stand the very large possibility of making a massive error in reasoning. Coming back to the data on O-rings, it is unreasonable to draw conclusions about the safety of launching the shuttle when it's 39 degrees outside based on the available data. This was the first of two major errors in statistical reasoning that led to this disaster. And before we get to the second reason, if you like what you see, if you could take a moment to like this video, subscribe to this channel, and click that little bell icon so that you don't miss out on any new content I put out, I would really appreciate it. With that said, let's explore the second major error that Thiokol and NASA engineers made. Again, coming back to this graph, what's critical to point out is that these data only include the failures. As in, this is plotting the relationship between failures and temperature, and not all launches and temperature. When we instead include all launches, we get a very different picture of how temperature and failure are related. Of the 23 shuttle launches prior to this disaster, 16 of them had absolutely no issues when it comes to O-rings. And in all of those cases, the launches took place on days where the temperature was relatively high. To be sure, there were a few higher temperature launches that also had some form of O-ring failures, but of the 7 launches that had a failure, most occurred during low temperature launches. In other words, when looking at all the data, launches that had any kind of O-ring failures and launches with no O-ring failures, the data tell a very different story about the relationship between temperature and failure rates. In fact, the story, the correct story, is that temperature does appear to influence the rate of O-ring failures. The colder it is, the more failure there seems to be. As another example, to make this type of error crystal clear, consider the following example of student grades from a European school. This chart shows the relationship between how many days a student misses classes and their grade on a 20-point scale. Looking only at students who missed classes at all, there really doesn't appear to be any kind of relationship here. You might then conclude that missing classes doesn't make a big difference in terms of what grade students earn. But if I instead also include all the students who missed no classes at all, you see a very different picture. The students who missed no classes did, on average, much better than those who missed any classes at all. In other words, there is a relationship between missing classes and success. It's just that the difference exists among students who have perfect attendance and those who miss any amount of class time at all. By ignoring that group of diligent students, we falsely conclude that absenteeism has no effect on grades when it clearly does. This is just like the Challenger data, where we ignore the launches with no failure and conclude, based on just some of the data, that temperature has no bearing on whether O-rings fail or not. Had the engineers looked at the totality of the data, they likely would have come to a very different conclusion about the safety of the Challenger mission. They might have chosen to delay the launch to wait for warmer weather. And this type of error happens in many places. Imagine if a factory only evaluated what caused product defects by just looking at the defective products and failing to look at the conditions that resulted in products having no defects. Or consider how the media chooses to cover the news, focusing almost exclusively on bad events, and ignoring that if we look at all events that happen in the world, the overwhelming majority are actually quite good. The point is that when considering the relationship between variables of any kind, it is critical to consider all the data in question and not just a subsample. Doing anything less can result in false conclusions, and in the tragic case of the Challenger, death. Finally, as always, thanks so much for watching.